Ich schau ins tiefe Tal hinab ins schöne Land Tirol. Ich sehe die weißen Nebel ziehen, die Sonne scheint ins Gwent.
Good morning, Axe friends. How are you? How are you in 2020, this new year? I hope it finds you well. I really do. I hope this is going to be a great year for all of you. All right, a little break in the weather. It's brought everyone out of their hovels here in Sisyphus Town. All right, you know, a little sun's coming out, peeking out through the clouds. So really wanted to do a little bit of pure axe science today. I'm super excited about this because we're going to check out a really unique pattern of axe, okay? A German pattern called the Oberharz pattern. Now listen to Google Translate like 15 times trying to get that right. Oberharz pattern. That's my best guess, okay? Oberharz. Named after a region in northern Germany, okay? A hilly region, the Harz. And the Oberharz is like the upper part of this region, right? It's the Oberharz pattern. So apparently, right, this is a thickly wooded area in the province of Saxony in Germany, okay? Which gave name to this unique pattern of axe. Really, really interesting. And so some dedicated viewers of this channel have helped me acquire 3 examples of this pattern. And I want to check them out, build them up, and see how they chop. So if you're into axes, it's not surprising that a pattern gets its name from some specific region where maybe it was developed, all right? It's true in the United States. In the United States, we have, you know, Connecticut patterns. We have Dayton patterns. Dayton's a town in Ohio, okay? Michigan patterns, Western patterns. There's a lot of correlation between the pattern names and the regions in which they were developed. So that's true in Germany. It's true in Australia, the Tasmanian pattern. Welsh pattern axes in the UK. Seems to be pretty typical of what's going on there. And I always wonder, like, okay, why? Like, you know, back in the day when some blacksmith, right, with great skill, decided he or she, probably he at the time, right, probably he at the time, wanted to develop a new kind of axe specifically for the timber in their country, right, the timber in their region where their customers were, and out comes, you know, the Puget Sound pattern for the big giant redwoods in the Pacific Northwest of the United States, or the Rhineland pattern, okay, in the Rhineland region of Germany, where that, you know, very famous pattern, duplicated many times and, you know, and copied and modified for various uses. So according to Wikipedia, in the Harz region of Germany, okay, they have a lot of beech and a lot of spruce. Now, if the spruce is anything like the spruce in my area of the world, that is some gummy wood. That is actually tough wood. It's technically a soft wood, but it's no soft job to cut. It doesn't chip well. It's very sticky, right? Hard to split green, all kinds of things going on. I'm not sure, you know, probably a different species in Germany, whatever, but it's possible that this pattern was developed with those woods in mind. Okay. So what do we got here with this German Oberharz pattern? All right, really interesting. All right, the first thing that just jumps out at me, this is actually the angle at which it is hafted. Okay, you know, the haft goes in here straight. That's straight, 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 straight. Almost every other axe, you know, there's not many axes I can think of. Nothing's coming to mind right now that's sort of hafted at an angle like that. Okay, and that's the way they all are. They're all at this angle. And, you know, and I'm wondering, like, okay, what was it thinking there, right? You know, I can only speculate at what was going on. You know, the blacksmith must have thought, you know, this force being sent into the handle maybe at an angle had some advantageous purpose, or the way it allowed the smiths to get some alignment thing going on with here. But you know, when I check the alignment on these, I do the little test and all that kind of stuff, it always turns out about typical of another pattern of axe. So maybe it was decorative, maybe it was distinctive to that region, and they felt like, oh, we really, really like that. Also, as a European eye, these are European eye patterns, okay? We've talked about that. You can still get them. There's companies in Germany still making this European eye format. And it's quite different. It's actually a lot different than you'd think in happening days, because it's just a different process in getting, you know, good alignment and all that with the flat back. But it's a decent idea. It certainly makes for a strong hang when you get a lot of pressure inside the eye, all right? So two of these guys are from the same company, an East German company that's today known as Bison, all right? Apparently Bison goes back quite a ways, you know, 1879 or something like that, maybe moved once or twice, but became part of East Germany, was a nationalized factory, and churned out tools, you know, under a nationalized socialist system. And this is one of them, all right? This marking is from the East Germany days. And if I'm told what the numbers mean, all right? So that's the weight stamp, 1200, and his brother is 1,000 grams, okay? 1200 grams being, you know, split about 2.64 pounds is what it says. And the TGL was some, you know, government established quality marker, okay, in German. There's something going on there. I've read, I can't pronounce it. What's somewhat interesting, if this was a government approved, you know, weight standard, they're way off on the 1200. The 1200 is actually a lot heavier than that. It's almost 1300 grams, okay? That's nearly 10% off of what, you know, the standard's supposed to be. So I don't know what's going on there, but I'm glad it is. I'm glad it is for performance reasons that we'll return to later in this video. The C60W3 is the steel. Now that is interesting, all right? That's C60 European steel. Roughly the equivalent, right? It's a tool steel. And the W's, apparently, you know, there's W1, W2, W3, and the W's indicate some quality, all right, some purity standard. W1 being the highest quality tool steel, 2 and 3 being lower qualities. So C60W3 might be the rough equivalent of 1060, all right, here in the States, and other similar steels. But they can vary, and the temper is so important. The temper really is so important. The manufacturing process has an effect. I did not believe that 2 years ago. I now do. It's one of the great debates, all right? You know, inside axe lore and axe nerdery is, you know, does any of this matter? You know, does any of this matter with the steels? You know, 0.4% carbon, 0.5, 0.6, what, you know, steel, ah, it goes on and on and on. So many factors go into that, but higher carbon steels can really deliver. They can really deliver if manufactured well. So this is going to be very interesting. So we got two East German brothers here, but this other guy, this is a Warder and Pondel. This is West German stuff, a Wuppertal axe. Yes, from the Wuppertal region, all right? Axe makers are clearly developed in clusters around where natural materials were available, you know, streams to power the mills, to power the hammers, etc., etc., okay? And Warder and Pondel was a big maker, quite famous. We did some videos on another Rhineland pattern axe we had from them. This guy's been worn down a bit, but not as much as you'd think. Even within patterns, you get lots of variation. It has a much smaller eye. Zoom into the small. It has a smaller eye, bigger, thicker pull. Okay, taller collar. So there's more weight back here around the handle than the East German version of that. But look how much that takes off the end. Takes so much off. And this one's probably been worn down a little bit, all right, but maybe not as much as we think. Somebody kept a really similar profile as they used it and sharpened it, all right? You know, maybe a conscientious user there. But the East German 1200 gram guy, zoom back out, oh, but the other way. There we go. This has got some real potential, axe friends. It's got some real potential. Like I said, it's overweight. It's almost 1300 grams, and at 2.8 pounds, that's in work axe category. So I look at this, okay, that's 12 and a half centimeters on the cutting edge. Really interesting curve, okay, definitely a technique. We need to take this one seriously. This could be a fairly high performer if we do it right. So handles are gonna be pretty key here, right? And with the European eye, it's a little tricky, right? A great handle can make a big axe feel small, and a small axe chop big, right? That's one of the axioms. It's true. So we got to pick some good handles to get the most out of these axes. So with the Warder and Pondel, all right, this little guy, a little bit underweight here from the wear. I've got an Ochsenkopf stock handle. They come with European eyes, so you can just buy them like that. All right, pretty close, pretty close. That's going to work out good and give us a decent length on the handle for that weight. But I got something crazy. Going to really go all out with this madness. Okay, I've been testing stains. I've been testing some stains, right? On this hickory handle up here. So this will all be gone. But look at this handle. This thing's crazy. Super thin, super curvy. All right, some call this the French curve. All right, French curve with an East German head. Very continental, very EU, right? You guys in the UK won't like that. Gotta get away from that. Gotta get out now, right? Soon, it'll all come true. We'll see how that works out. But it has enough eye wood up here. There's enough wood up here. It's huge. All right, I can modify and cut and get this to probably work with that European eye. Okay, nice flat back, big long extension. The style seems to be a lot of this would be the shoulder of a European style axe. You know, the shoulder's big and long. Okay, that's the way they prefer it. I kind of like the curve to get a little bit closer there and the shoulder to go right into the eye. Seems a preference for me, but it is a legitimate style. So we're going to hang these pretty high and get some good length out of this, particularly with this guy. This could be a really neat axe if that feels good once we get it all hafted up. Check it out. Yeah, couldn't help myself with the Ochsenkopf handle. Those are just big beefy boys. You can take so much off, and I did. And I did a little bit of burning pattern here, okay, with a small torch. You know, when you use a small torch, as opposed to a big torch, I don't want to dig out the big torch. Small torch, you get this kind of leopard pattern going here. You know, that's kind of what it does, a small little flame. A little more difficult to get just on the grain, get that grainy kind of look. But, you know, can we not acknowledge that, you know, World War II German desert pattern camouflage is one of the greatest camouflage patterns of all time. You know, that's particularly on the Panzer tanks. It's outstanding. Went for a little Panzer action here. I think that's going to be all right for the Warder. All right, the Warder and Pondell. And for our East German... All right, Bison, we're ready to go on this French curve hickory guy. That's going to be nice. All right, so let's half these up.
Da, da, da. Thank you.
our Harz patterns are ready to go. We have different weights, different lengths of handles, a lot of different styles to test here to see how this pattern takes on the woods in my area. That was a lot of fun. Hope you learned something. If you have any questions about any of the techniques I used during the sexy time phase, just put those down below. Be more than happy to share my experience with any of those techniques, you know, what they do. So anyways, so we have three acts. We got to give them names. I mean, we got to give them names now, right? So on the far left, this is a donated axe. Very appreciative of this axe that's come from Andre Meyer in Basel, Switzerland. An axe he built himself called the Steinman Special, because the handle on there, this is a European hardware store handle, quote unquote, right? The hardware store handle. We all know the handles available at our local hardware stores, right? They're not very good, but they're highly, highly typical, right? They're highly typical of whatever that store buys and provides for their, you know, it's the same all over the world. When I was in Sweden, they got the Jula, right? J-U-L-A. It's Home Depot. It's Lowe's. There's no difference. Even the categories of the things that you'll find, right? Oh, I wonder what, you know, this is in Switzerland. You know, there it is. There's the exact same thing. You know, it's all one giant machine providing us our goods and giving us our choices. So maybe that's one of the fun things about fixing up old tools, as you can go a million different directions and now it's one of a kind. It's one of a kind. You're not going to find it on the rack at Home Depot. No, sir. Steinman Special, very nice. 2.2 pounds, 23 and a half inches. That is a powerful handle length. I have a lot of respect for that length of handle in a small axe. It seems to be a kind of optimum between too small, losing power, too big. Now it's a larger, full-sized axe, and you could probably do better with more weight on the head. But what we got here now with the Warder and Pundell, a little bit heavier, we got an assault axe. That's what this is. This is straight up assault axe. We're naming this one the Stug 3 Assault Axe. Yes. Memorial, the camouflage pattern inspired me. I particularly liked this particular version of the camouflage pattern on the Stug 3 assault gun at the Third Battle of Kharkov. 1943, unidentified unit, right? Showed up in some photograph somewhere. Hey, when did we ever use that pattern? That nobody knows. Nobody knows. It was just some unit. And you know, all your prior service guys, you know what happened out there. Third Battle of Kharkov, right? Maintenance section said, fuck it, right? Maintenance section's back there sitting in the parts truck, right? Trailing behind the tanks off to the Third Battle of Kharkov, you know, and they're running the numbers. Mates, we're not going to live through this. Nobody's going to survive any of this. The whole thing's doomed. We're going down. We might as well paint the tanks, right, the way we want to paint the tanks. That's what I think happened. And that's what I think happened. So we got a pretty cool leopard camo pattern thing going on here. Kind of go with the Stug 3 Assault Axe. Should be a lot more fun, a little more length on the handle. So we'll call this one the Stug 3, right? All right. And I had a hard time coming up with a name for our East German large. This is the one, I'm very excited to swing this axe. This could be a pretty high performer because of the weight of the head and the length of the handle. It's a nice premium, you know, thin to narrow handle. A lot more out of that and ton of cutting edge out there. Super thin, thin, sharp. I have ground this guy down to the danger zone. Yeah, 18 degrees, no micro bevel. We are gonna put that C60 W3 to the full test, right? So why not call it the Luftballoon? Right? I almost chose 99 Luftballoons for the little music section, but could not resist the kooky proto-techno 80s pop hit of Da Da Da, right? Just gets in your head. What is it about the Germans and their pop music? It is so catchy. It is so catchy, always coming up with catchy little things. So out of respect for another great 1980s German pop song, Luftballoon, all right, it's going to the woods. But that'll be the next video, right? We got to pick some other axes to compare it to and take these out and do an axe arena, see how they fare, all right? But that'll be next time. Thanks for watching. Like and subscribe, I suppose. I will do the videos anyways, but it's helpful to have more subscribers. And all of you who are new to the channel and actually listen through this whole video, thank you very much, right? Hope you learned something. I always do. So, see you next time.